بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وبعد. So جزاك الله خير brothers for attending this lesson, and we're starting a new book called أصول الثلاثة, the three fundamental principles, which is we're going through the explanation, or we will be going through the explanation of Sheikh Fawzan. We'll be going through the explanation of Sheikh Fawzan, and we'll be covering various principles, the fundamentals of the deen that are related to Tawheed and Aqeedah. We just finished a book called Usul al-Sitta by the same author, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, and that was quite beneficial for us. So inshallah, we'll continue that benefit of going through the basics, inshallah. So the Sheikh, he begins the book with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, and praises Allah, and the same salutations, prayers and salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions and those who follow him. Then the Sheikh continues and says, "Wa ba'd." So for the new brothers, just before I start, for the new brothers, we're just reading the Arabic and then we're translating it. So we're reading Arabic and translating it. So inshallah, that'll be the way we'll be going through each lesson. So the Shaykh continues and says, فَبَيْنَ أَيْدِينَا هَذِي رِسَالَةٌ رِسَالَةُ ثَلَاثَةُ الْأُصُولِ وَهِيَ رِسَالَةٌ جَلِيلَةٌ مُخْتَصَرَةٌ مُؤَيِّدَةٌ بِالْأَدِلَّةِ مِنْ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ وَسُنَّةِ رَسُولِهِ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Shaykh says, so in front of us, this book, in front of us is this treatise, small treatise, called the three fundamental principles, which is a treatise, which is a magnificent treatise, which is summarized, a magnificent summarized treatise, aided by the Quran and Sunnah, or aided by evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then he continues. He says, "وهذه الرسالة في أصل عظيم من أصول الإسلام وهو العقيدة وكان العلماء يهتمون بهذه المختصرات يؤلفونها ويتعبون على اختصارها وتهذيبها ثم يحفظونها لطلبتهم لتبقى أصولا عندهم وذخيرة يستفيدون منها ويفيدون منها." So then the Sheikh, he says, and this book or this treatise that we're going through is a great pillar or a great foundation from the foundations of Al-Islam, and it is the Aqeedah. So Aqeedah of our religion, our belief. And he goes on to say, he says, the scholars of old, the scholars used to give this book great concern, or this treatise great concern. They used to summarize it, make notes, explain it away for their students when they used to deliver lessons. And they preserved it so that it would be a benefit for their students and for them as well, and that they could benefit from these great principles that inshallah we are going to cover during our lessons and going through this book. Then the Shaykh continues and he says, وَالْبِدَاءَةَ بِهَذِهِ الْمُخْتَصَرَاتِ هِيَ الْأَسَاسِ لِطَلَبَةِ الْعِلْمِ فَطَالِبُ الْعِلْمِ يَبْدَأُ بِالتَّعَلُّمْ شَيْئًا فَشَيْئًا يَأْخُذُ مِنْ مَبَادِئِ الْعِلْمِ وَأُصُولِهِ وَيَتَدَرَّجْ فِيهِ. So then the Shaykh, he goes on to say, and he says that this book or these fundamental principles are the basis for any student of knowledge or for the student of knowledge. So the student of knowledge, he begins by learning step by step, or bit by bit, taking the introductory knowledge or the foundation knowledge first, and then graduating step by step increasing in knowledge, starting from the smaller books and the smaller affairs, and then going to bigger affairs, step by step in that order. Then the Shaykh continues and he says, فَهَذِهِ الْمُخْتَصَرَاتِ طَرِيقُ الْمُطَوَّلَاتِ فَلَا يُمْكِنُ أَن تُفْهَمَ الْمُطَوَّلَاتِ إِلَّا بَعْدَ فَهْمَ الْمُخْتَصَرَاتِ وَالتَّدَرُّجُ مِنْهَا شَيْئًا فَشَيْئًا. وَلِهَذَا قَالُوا فِي مَعْنَى قَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى وَلَكِنْ كُونُوا رَبَّانِيِّينَ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تُعَلِّمُونَ الْكِتَابَ وَبِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَدْرُسُونَ. So the Shaykh says, and so you can only learn the more lengthier affairs or the more detailed matters in the religion by way of starting with the smaller pieces of knowledge or the introductory or foundations of our deen. So the foundational matters, the smaller affairs first. And that if we do that correctly, then it'll give us a good standing for being able to understand and comprehend the bigger affairs, or those affairs that are more detailed and require more detail and knowledge. And then the Shaykh mentions a Quran ayah that we just read from Surah Ali Imran, verse 79. And if we look at that, Surah Ali Imran, verse 79. If you go to verse 79, if you have a translation of the Quran, you can also look at this. Verse 79. And verse 79, which we read. The whole ayah, we'll read the whole ayah. مَا كَانَ لِبَشَرٍ أَن يُؤْتِيَهُ اللَّهُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحُكْمَ وَالنَّبُوَّةَ ثُمَّ يَقُولَ لِلنَّاسِ كُونُوا عِبَادًا لِي مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ وَلَكِن كُونُوا رَبَّانِيِّينَ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تُعَلِّمُونَ الْكِتَابَ وَبِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَدْرُسُونَ. So if you read the translation of that, it is not possible for any human being to whom Allah has given the book and al-hikmah, the knowledge and understanding of the laws of religion, etc., and prophethood, to say to the people, be my worshippers rather than Allah's. On the contrary, he would say, be you Rabbaniyun, learned men of religion who practice what they know and also preach others or to others, because you are teaching the book and you are studying it. So that goes nicely with what the Shaykh said earlier. So then if you continue, the Shaykh continues and he says, إن الربانيين هم الذين يبدأون بصغار مسائل العلم قبل كباره يربون أنفسهم وطلابهم ابتداء من المسائل الصغيرة إلى المسائل الكبيرة وهذا شيء طبيعي لأن كل الأشياء تبدأ من أصولها وأساساتها ثم تكبر وتعظم بعد ذلك فأما الذي يهجم على العلم هجوما من علاه أو من علاه فهذا يتعب ولا يحصل على شيء بينما الذي يبدأ من الأصول ويتدرج هذا هو الذي بإذن الله يسير مع الطريق الصحيح والاتجاه السليم. So then the Shaykh continues from where he left off and he said, excuse me, he says, the learned men, the scholars are those who start with the smaller affairs, with the foundational affairs of the deen before the greater affairs or the more detailed affairs. And they culture themselves and they, culture themselves upon that, and their students as well. Beginning with the smaller affairs in the deen and the more basic and foundational affairs of the deen first, and then going up from there to the more detailed and more more complex affairs of the deen. And the Shaykh says that this is something which is natural, because everything, it begins with these foundations. Everything, when you begin something, you begin with the foundations first, and then from there, you increase in knowledge and the affair becomes more greater and more complex. But you start with the simple things and the foundational affairs first. So then the Sheikh says, so he goes, so as for the one who delves into or dives into seeking knowledge from its uppermost part, as in the more complex affairs first, this person becomes tired. He'll become tired and he won't obtain anything in the end. He wouldn't have learned anything. And all the while, beginning from the foundations and, you know, building up from there, whoever does that, bi-idhnillah, by the permission of Allah, is traversing upon the correct path of seeking knowledge. And that's, you know, the correct way of seeking knowledge. Then the Shaykh continues and he says, هَاُولَاءِ سَأَلُوا عَنِ الْأَهِلَّةِ لماذا يبدأ الهلال صغيرا ثم يكبر حتى يتكامل ثم يصغر حتى يعود هلالا فعتب الله عليهم ووجههم إلى السؤال عما ينفعهم وأن يأتوا بيوت العلم من أبوابها. So then the Shaykh Qutubi says, excuse me, he gives us an example. He says that those who asked about the crescent, you know, the moon, they asked about the moon and timings and the moon. Why did they ask about, and then says, why at the beginning, or why did they begin asking about the hilal, as in the crescent, as in the crescent is the smallest fraction of the moon, isn't it? The crescent is the beginning, and then it gets bigger and bigger. So the Shaykh is giving an example. Why did they ask about the crescent first? And then it gets bigger and bigger up until you have a full moon and it's complete. Then it decreases again in size up until it becomes a hilal again. So the Shaykh says that then obviously he's referring to the Quran. And we will cover that, the particular ayah in the Quran regarding the al-ahilla or the hilal. And the Shaykh mentions here that, you know, that Allah replies to them or answers their question in that which benefits them. So Allah gives them the answer about the moon, but in terms of only that which benefits us, right? Of course. And that you come and that you seek knowledge from its doors or from its proper entry paths, that you seek the knowledge in the correct way. The Shaykh continues, he'll explain this in a bit more detail. أَمَّا سُؤَالُ عَنِ الْهِلَالِ وَأَهْوَالِهِ وَصِغَرِهِ وَكِبْرِهِ فَهَذَا لَا فَائِدَةَ لَهُمْ فِيهِ بَلِ الْفَائِدَةَ هِيَ أَنْ يَسْأَلُوا أَمَّا يَحْتَاجُونَ إِلَيْهِ وَهُوَ مَعْرِفَةَ فَوَائِدَ الْأَهِلَّةِ وَلِهَذَا قَالَ قُلْ هِيَ مَوَاقِيتُ لِلنَّاسِ بَيَّنَ لَهُمْ فَوَائِدُهَا وَفَوَائِدَهَا وهي أن الله جعلها مواقيت للناس يعرفون بها العبادات والمعاملات والآجال وغير ذلك. So his answer. So the Shaykh says, continues, he says, as for the question regarding the crescent and the moon and etc. and its condition, how it changes from the crescent, it becomes a half moon, full moon, and the different phases, that there's no benefit in just knowing that, okay, you know, asking about the phase and why it changes. However, says the Shaykh says, rather the benefit is in what we need. Why do we need that? Why is it there? Why do we need the moon, for example, and why are those phases there? And basically, and the benefits of that is what Allah said in the Quran. قُلْ هِيَ مَوَاقِيتُ لِلنَّاسِ. So there's our answer for regarding the moon and its phases. Is so it helps us to track time, right? Helps us to track time. So the Shaykh continues and he says, for example, that Allah has made it a way for us to track time, and therefore we can carry out our ibadat at the correct times. We're able to carry out, you know, our daily lives with, you know, with regards to the time, you know, etc. And other than that, then the Shaykh continues and he says, فَأَرْشَدَهُمْ إِلَى فَوَائِدَ الْأَهِلَّةِ وَلَمْ يُجِبْهُمْ عَنْ سُؤَالِهِمْ عَنْ حَقِيقَةِ الْأَهِلَّةِ لِأَنَّ لَيْسَ لَهُمْ فِي ذَلِكَ فَائِدَةً وَلْيُوَجِّهَهُمْ إِلَى مَا يَنْبَغِي أَنْ يَسْأَلُوا عَنْهُ وَهُوَ أَبْوَابُ الْعِلْمِ لَا ظُهُورَ الْعِلْمِ وَالْمَسَائِلُ الْفُضُولِيَّةُ الَّتِي لَا يَحْتَاجُونَ إِلَيْهَا وَإِنْ احْتَاجُوا إِلَيْهَا فَهِيَ حَاجَةٌ قَلِيلَةٌ. Then the Sheikh says, and he reminds them, he says, that when Allah answered that question about the moon and the timing and what its purpose is, which we've discussed, then the Sheikh mentions that Allah pointed us towards that which benefits us and didn't busy us with knowing about the reality of the moon, because it doesn't benefit us. Knowing the reality of the moon doesn't really benefit us. Rather, knowing that the moon is there to help us tell the time and track the time to carry out our daily lives and tasks, including our ibadat, of course, that's the benefit. And the Shaykh mentions that and just clarifies that for us. And so he mentions also that that's why we shouldn't be hung up with the fuduliyat. So, for example, things that don't really benefit us, you know, you could talk about it and you could discuss it, but it would actually have no real benefit. It's a waste of time, basically. So those things that waste our time and has no benefit, that we stay away from it. And that's what the Sheikh finishes on there. And this is the Sheikh who's explaining the book. That's the introduction there that we finished from Sheikh Saleh Fawzan. And now we'll move on to the introduction of the original author, Sheikh al-Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. And so we'll begin. The Sheikh says, قَالَ رَحِمُهُ اللَّهُ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ ابْتَدَأَ رَحِمُهُ اللَّهُ هَذِهِ الرِّسَالَةِ بِالْبَسْمَلَةِ اقْتِدَاءً بِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ فإن أول ما يقع عليه بصرك في المصحف أو مصحف وقبل كل سورة منه بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. So then Sheikh says, he says, the original author, rahimahullah, may Allah have mercy upon him, he starts with, or he begins with, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Then the Sheikh goes and continues and he says that he began with, may Allah have mercy upon him, he began his book or his treatise with Bismillah Rahman Rahim, in accordance with the Quran and the Sunnah, or the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So he gives the example. The evidence is that when we look at the Mushaf, the Quran, and when we're reading it, every surah, I know except one surah, but generally speaking, every surah begins with, as we know, Bismillah Rahman Rahim. And so that's the evidence that this is in following the example of the Quran. And of course, the Shaykh will explain about the Sunnah as well of the Prophet. So then he continues and he says, فَالْبِدَاءَةُ بِهَا فِي الرَّسَائِلِ وَفِي الْكُتُبِ وَفِي الْمُؤَلَّفَاتِ اقْتِدَاءً بِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ. So as we see in many different books, Islamic books, we see this example, you know, starting with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Then the Shaykh continues, he says, وكذلك النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يكتبها في أول رسائله حينما يكتب إلى الأمراء والرؤساء وإلى من في أقطار الأرض يدعوهم إلى الإسلام يبدأ كتابته ببسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. And likewise, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم also when he would begin something, he would begin with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And also when he used to write to the various leaders and governors and rulers that is around his time, when he used to write letters to them, he would start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And so those are two evidences there, that starting with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is following the Book of Allah and following the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Shaykh continues and says, وَكَانَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَفْتَتِحُ أَحَدِيثَهُ وَكَلَامَهُ بِبِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ مِمَّا يَدُلُّ عَلَىٰ أَنَّ الْبِدَاءَةَ في بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم سنة الرسول كما كان سليمان عليه السلام لما كتب إلى بلقيس ملكة سبأ بدأ كتابه ببسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قالت يا أيها الملأ إني ألقي إلي كتاب كريم إنه من سليمان وإنه بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألا تعلوا علي وأتوني مسلمين ينبغي البدء ببسم الله الرحمن الرحيم في كل أمر له أهمية وكل مؤلف له أهمية وله قيمة وكل رسالة. So then the Sheikh continues and he says, so he continues with what we just finished off, and he says, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would, whenever he, before he would speak, he would say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, for example. And also likewise, Sulaiman, how Sulaiman was commanded to say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And likewise, as we read in the ayah, the Surah An-Naml, verse 29 to 31, where you can refer to that Surah An-Naml, verse 29 and verse 31, which mentions when Sulaiman is commanded to say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, when he writes a letter to Bilqis, the ruler of the ruler of Sabah at that time. And so the Sheikh, he says that, so therefore, in every important affair, in every important thing you do, an important affair, you know, it's a must, it's incumbent that you start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And I believe the Sheikh will explain also in a bit more detail, as in what that actually means in more detail than what we know. So inshallah, we'll go through that as well. وعلى هذا فالذين لا يبدأون مؤلفاتهم ورسائلهم ببسم الله الرحمن الرحيم هؤلاء تركوا السنة النبوية والاقتداء بكتاب الله عز وجل وربما بسبب ذلك أن كتبهم هذه ورسائلهم أو رسائلهم ليس فيها بركة وليس فيها فائدة لأنها إذا خلت من بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم فإنها منزوعة الفائدة. So the Sheikh also mentions and he says, so for example, those who begin, let's say for example, their books, whether they author their writings, for example, as one example, if they don't begin with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, of course, they have left the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they've left the Sunnah of Allah Himself, of course, from the Kitab of Allah. And maybe the Sheikh mentions this as well. He says, and maybe because of that, because of them leaving off the Basmala in their writings, for example, you may find that they won't have any barakah or any blessing in what they set out to do in their authorship, for example, whatever they've authored, for example, in just this one example that's given here, and therefore there's no benefit because it is void of the basmala, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, and therefore it is void of benefit. And so now, just before we finish today's lesson, we'll go through the benefits. The Sheikh mentions the benefits of the Basmala, which is Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, what it actually means as well, in terms of grammar, Arabic grammar as well, to help us understand. So the Sheikh continues and says, لِمَاذَا تَرَكُوا بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ إِنَّمَا تَرَكُوهَا لِأَنَّهَا إِنَّهَا سُنَّةٌ وَهُمْ يَنْفِرُونَ مِنَ السُّنَّةِ أو يقلدون من ينفر من السنة فينبغي التنبه لمثل هذا. So the Sheikh says, so he goes, why have they left off the Basmallah, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Why have they left it off? He says, indeed, they've left it off because it is a sunnah, i.e., sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they are fleeing from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Or they are blind following one who has fleed from the sunnah. Therefore, it's incumbent to note and pay attention to this example. Then the Shaykh continues and he says, فَمَعْنَا بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ أَلِسْتِيَانَ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ أو أَلِسْتِيَانَ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ. So the meaning of بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ is seeking the aid by mentioning the name of Allah. So for example, it says, فَقَوْلُهُ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ جَارٌ وَمَجْرُورٌ مُتَعَلِّقٌ بِمَحْذُوفٌ تَقْدِيرُهُ أَسْتَعِينُ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ أَوْ أَبْتَدِعُ بِبِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ تَبَرُّكًا بِهَا وَاسْتِعَانَةً بِاللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. There's a bit of grammar here, a bit difficult explaining in English, but I'll try my best. So the Shaykh mentioned, he says, it's jar majroor. That's quite difficult to explain that in English. But essentially, what's being said here is that when you say Bismillah or Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, you are calling upon Allah and seeking His aid and His assistance and His blessing. And that, in a lot of Arabic, for example, in a lot of Arabic, you'll find that you will say something or something may be said, and there is also a meaning there or a sentence there that is not present, but it's understood. I'll give you an example. So one example was here, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. We know what that means. However, this sentence here is not there, but it's understood. The sentence that I ask Allah for assistance, aid and assistance and blessing, that's actually not in Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. However, it's understood, right? In the Arabic language. Give another example. In the Shahada, in the first Shahada, La ilaha illallah. Yeah, La ilaha illallah. If you just translated La ilaha illallah straight off into English, for example, we all speak English here, so we'll use that example. If we just translated it straight off like that, without understanding it, we would say, there is no God, right? La ilaha, there's no God, but God. But a deity, right? But that doesn't stand right, because there's a sentence within La ilaha illallah that's understood, but it's not there. A good example now. So we'll explain that. La ilaha illallah, if you look at the translation of La ilaha illallah, the full translation, it is that there is no God or no deity worthy of worship in truth except Allah alone. That's what it means. You see? So this is quite common in Arabic, but it's clear. The point is clear though. So it'll be clear. You'll be able to see that it means that. It won't be like, okay, you pick up anything from the Quran or the Hadith or whatever, and you say, oh yeah, this means that, that means that. No, it's something that's understood by the Arabs, right? It's well known. It's not something that people can then come with, for example, and say, oh, this means that, and this means that, and they go far away from the actual meaning. So just make that point there. And then the Shaykh continues and says, فَهِيَ مَطْلَعٌ عَظِيمٌ لِلْكَلَامِ وَلِلْكُتُبِ وَالرَّسَائِلِ فَالْإِنسَانُ يَسْتَعِينُ بِاللَّهِ فِي بِدَايَتِهَا وَيَتَبَرَّكْ بِاسْمِهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. So then the Shaykh says, this is it's a great affair. It's a very important matter. In terms of, you know, the Basmallah, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in speech, and in books when you're writing, whether it be a book, whether it be a letter or anything, etc. And so mankind will seek Allah's aid in the beginning of anything. So when he begins something, he seeks Allah's aid. And therefore, and by Allah's name, he seeks Allah's blessings. So inshallah, we'll finish there. today. So we finished both introductions of the expert, the one the Sheikh was explaining the book, and also the original author. And inshallah, next week we will begin with the first treatise, which covers four areas regarding four important points, which are covered in Surah Al-Asr. Yeah, so inshallah, we'll come back to that next week. And it'll be next same time next week, inshallah. The lessons every Friday at 8. If there's any changes, I will inform.